It's my great pleasure to introduce what is going to be a terrific panel. Nobody can replace Stephen Chu. And so we've done a little bit of last-minute recalibrating. And we asked, actually, Orville kindly offered to serve as a panelist as opposed to a moderator. He's great in both roles. And so I'm going to moderate the conversation today, which I think is going to fall really into the category of what comes next, really, for China, which has made a remarkable commitment to clean energy, to California, which I think made that commitment pretty much before everybody else, and to Washington, which is regretfully moving in the wrong direction. And I speak as somebody whose wife, full disclosure, works for U.S. EPA and is back in Washington, D.C. right now working at the on the transition. So it's a little rough in our household, too, at this moment. But I think what we're looking at is a shift in a lot of ways, and today's panel is going to address that. And I can think of no one better to start the ball rolling than Matt Rodriguez, who is the Secretary of California's EPA, has a long history in justice and environmental issues, and I think he'll start us off with a quick keynote. And then I'll ask Drew Bohan from the Energy Commission and Orville to back clean up and talk a little bit about the shifts they see coming. We'll then go into a period of some questions that I will ask, and then there will be time for audience questions, which are often the most interesting part of the discussion. So we will have those as well. So, Matt?
Well, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here this morning. And yes, I agree, you can't replace Stephen Chu, but I will do my best to get us started here today. To figure out where we're going, it's helpful, I think, to see where we've been. And so let me tell you a little bit about my experience at Cal EPA over the last 6 years. Significantly, I knew coming into the agency that climate change was a very, very important issue to the governor. I'd been fortunate enough to work with the governor when he was the attorney general of the state of California. I knew his commitment to dealing with climate change. I knew that he felt that it is really the principal threat to the world today. So I knew he was committed to supporting California's existing programs on climate change. And I knew that that was going to be a major focus of my work over the governor's two terms, because we assumed he was going to have two terms as a governor. But what I wasn't prepared for when I got into the agency was the number of questions that we encountered and continued to encounter about, well, why is California going off and dealing with climate change on its own? It's only responsible for 1% of the greenhouse gas emissions. Are we going to ruin the California economy? California had a significant deficit at that particular point in time. And so there are questions about whether we should really go ahead with these programs. What was instructive to me was, however, the number of other countries that were interested in what California was doing. And in particular, China was very interested in what we were doing. I wasn't totally prepared for that. In fact, one of my first meetings as secretary was with a large delegation of Chinese officials. And what became immediately clear to me upon talking to them was that they knew more about California's then nascent cap and trade program than I did. They had very, very clearly studied what we were doing in California. They also knew quite a bit about our air quality programs, and they were interested in dealing with what they saw as a growing problem with air quality in China. That's instructive because that initial interaction with the Chinese government gave me an argument when I was going and talking to the California legislature, when I was talking to others in California, saying, no, it's a misconception to think that California is taking on these issues of climate change by itself. There are other governments around the world that are interested in climate change and are doing something about climate change. And importantly, that includes China. And I don't think people realize the extent to which China, back in 2011, 2012, was really looking at how are they going to deal with climate change. That grows through the years to the governor's visit to China in 2013. That was a trade mission, but it was also a mission to talk to Chinese government officials about what we could do collaboratively on climate change issues. We signed an MOU with the NDRC so we could collaborate on dealing with the issues that you need to deal with when you're setting up an emissions trading program. We signed an MOU with the Ministry for Environmental Protection to look at air quality issues and share information on air quality issues. At the local level, we were working with the Beijing Environmental Protection Bureau, and they expressed a great interest in talking to us about how we control or regulate vehicle emissions in California, because vehicle emissions are a big problem and a big cause of air pollution issues in China. And again, those interactions, those discussions that we had while we were in China were very instructive to me, because they showed the depth of commitment and understanding in China of some of these issues. And we found that we really shared some common objectives and goals. I went back to China later in 2013 and then went back again in 2014 to have discussions on how we could make sure that the technical experts in California were working closely with the technical experts in China. So that's sort of the development of Chinese and California cooperation from my perspective and my experience. Over the last several years then, I have not been back to China, but there's been a great deal of discussion at the technical level. So I sign, you know, it's one of the interesting things about California. It's an enormous state with 39 million people. There's 6,000 people in my agency. But if somebody is going to travel outside of the United States, I have to personally sign off on their out-of-state travel form. So I know who's going in and out of the state of California. And I can tell you there's been a great deal of exchange between China and California over the last several years. We're sending people from our Air Resources Board to China to talk about our low-carbon fuel standard and what we're doing on low-carbon fuels in California. We've been sending people to Beijing to discuss our auto emissions program, and we had members of the Beijing Environmental Protection Bureau who worked for 3 months within the Air Resources Board to see how our vehicle emissions program worked. We're talking about zero emission vehicles. We're talking about what you can do to control air pollution. While we've been doing that, we were fortunate that at the federal level, the federal government stepped up in the Obama administration. And there was a declaration between the United States and China about our shared commitment to deal with climate change. Then there was the presidential statement that came from President Obama and President Xi on that signaled China's commitment to work with the United States and the United States' commitment to work with China to deal with climate change. Very, very positive developments. So from the California perspective, we could continue to do our technical work with China, exchange information about our programs, but we knew at the federal level, China and the United States were working collaboratively, and I think that that had a great impact on the international discussions that were going on regarding climate change at that time. And I think that that Chinese and U.S. cooperation was a good signal that governments should feel comfortable signing the Paris Agreement that came out of the UN CCC meeting in 2015 in Paris. So great progress was being made, good working relationship with China, and in fact, I'll just say at the California level, we established a group called the Under Two Coalition, which is committed to keeping global warming below 2 degrees Celsius. And we focused on regions and subnational governments around the world, those governments that were actually doing something on the ground to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. We have a number of signatories from China, as well as signatories from all of the other continents of the world. Symbolic of our commitment in California to working with the world to deal with climate change. Now that we've got the change in the administration, now that we do have skeptics in the federal administration, we're recalibrating here in California. And what I mean by that is we're not doubting our programs. We're not second-guessing whether we should continue with our programs. It just means that we have to be more committed to making our programs work, more committed to working internationally. And I think that what that means is we need to be more committed to working with China and making sure that the good working relationship we've established so far continues, and that we be visible in that working relationship, that we let people know that the future is in clean technologies, it's changing to cleaner energy sources, it's cleaning up your industries, it's dealing with air pollution, it's moving to zero emission vehicles. And there may be some question about where the U.S. federal government is going on this, but we're not going to wait for them. We're going to continue in California to work with our partners around the world to address climate change and to make progress in these various sectors. So that's how I see the next couple of years unfolding. It's ambitious, but it has to be done. So that's sort of my view of the lay of the land.
Thank you, Matt. I'd like to give Drew Bohan the floor. He's the deputy chief of the California Energy Commission and one of the agencies tasked with actually carrying out the instructions that Matt has just laid out here.
Thanks, Bruce, and thanks very much for having us. I also want to thank Robert Sue in the back there, who helped coordinate a bunch of very difficult schedules. The California Energy Commission is a really exciting place to be these days if you're interested in these issues. We're not going to solve our climate problems and our pollution problems if we don't dramatically change the way we consume energy, both in the way we light our buildings and heat our homes and businesses and run our industries and move from place to place. Because by far, as probably most of you know in this room, the vast majority of the pollution comes from those sources. When you're flanked by an author of 14 books, 9 of which are on China, and a cabinet secretary, you'd be well advised to keep your comments short, so I'll do that. I know we also want to get to questions, but I did want to give a quick history of where we've been in energy from the Energy Commission's perspective and touch on some of the issues we focus on every day. So in the early 1970s, during the energy crisis, there was a report commissioned by the RAND Corporation to look at what California's electricity needs would be in the coming years. And it concluded that we would be growing about 8% per year, and we would need about 120 power plants, natural gas-fired power plants, or 40 nuclear plants. And many envisioned our coast being lined every 10 or 20 miles with these plants. And others had other ideas, and thus the Energy Commission was born out of that. President Reagan signed the bill that created then Governor Reagan signed the bill that created the Energy Commission in 1974, and then Governor Brown appointed the first 5 California Energy Commissioners. Fast forward to today, and my 5 bosses are all appointed by the very same Governor Jerry Brown in a obviously a different term. As we look at the projections back then of what things could look like and the promise of what the Energy Commission and the folks whose shoulders I step on in the few years I've been here and try to move the Energy Commission forward, we've really done an amazing set of things in the state, and our growth rate has been very modest. Our per capita electricity growth rate has been pretty much flat since 1970 as compared to the rest of the country, which has gone quite steeply up. And this is even in the face of our plug loads increasing dramatically in the last decade or so. We're not at the Energy Commission solely responsible for these successes, but we played a pretty significant role. A couple things I wanted to touch on that are challenges that China and California are facing and where we're working together, have worked together, and are planning to continue to do so in the future. Want to talk very briefly about renewable energy, about transportation, and about energy efficiency. So with renewable energy, Governor Brown in January of 2015 announced a state goal to, by 2030, have half of all of the electricity consumed in California come from renewable energy. Many thought that was a pretty ambitious goal and perhaps not likely to be achieved. As you look at the landscape today, we're more than halfway there. And that doesn't include hydro, which isn't counted in California as a renewable resource, despite its very low carbon impact. And that's add that to behind the meter electricity, like solar panels on roofs and that sort of thing, also not counted in that figure of about 27% renewables today. And you're up closer to about 40%. So as we look at the trajectory going forward, 50% by 2030 is very doable. And the interim step of 33% by 2020 is we've already got the contracts in place at the major utilities to achieve that goal. So things are going well there. We have a lot to learn, I think, from China on this front, because if you look at the installed capacity of solar in China, China, obviously much larger, but added in last year alone, added about twice as much solar capacity as all of California has in place throughout the entire time California's been focusing on solar energy. So we have a lot to learn. We have very similar challenges. California, many of you may know, is faced with, in some cases, too much of a good thing. A lot of solar energy at the middle of the day. I grew up when the focus was on doing your laundry and running your dishwasher after you got home from work, and it's flipped. Now we've got a lot more energy in midday, and we're trying to encourage folks to change that thinking. China, similarly, is ramped up so quickly with renewables that it, too, is facing this problem. This, I believe, though, is a very, very good problem to have. So we're working closely on research issues and logistics issues and planning. It may be sunny in one part of the country, not sunny in the other part. The wind's blowing in one part, not in the other. There are ways to share that make this problem a logistical one and not a really particularly overwhelming one. Second, I wanted to just touch briefly on transportation. California has made a big investment in transportation. We at the Energy Commission invest $100 million per year in electric vehicle infrastructure, hydrogen infrastructure, and biofuels and the vehicles that utilize that infrastructure. Air Resources Board that reports to Matt is similarly working on those sorts of issues, but that's what our commitment is. China is also very committed to electric vehicles, and in, I believe, the latest figure I got was 2015, they added 331,000 plug-in electric vehicles, which is more than all of California in California's history of electric vehicles, and a little more than half of the entire country just in 1 year. So we, again, I think really need to look to China to figure out how they've been so successful, and the problem of too much power being produced, not necessarily at the time that the demand is the highest, can be in part met by using our electric vehicles smartly. And if we can have them charge up while folks are at work, we're really in the very early days of figuring out how all these pieces fit together. But again, I think it's an exciting time. And then briefly, I just want to close with a conversation about energy efficiency, which has really been the Energy Commission's wheelhouse for the last 40 years. We focus on buildings and on appliances. The building we're in was built in 1983, if Wikipedia is accurate, which means that it was built, the law required that it was built to the standards that the Energy Commission had adopted at that time, and these are minimum energy efficiency standards. If the building were built today, it would be substantially more efficient because it would be required to meet the codes of today, and about every 3 years we update these codes. To give you a sense of how what the savings look like from these codes, we adopted the most recent building code update went into effect last year in 2016, and all of our building codes and our appliance codes are required by law to be cost effective. That is, the savings associated with the measures must exceed the cost of putting them in. And there's a lot of ways to look at how to measure this, but from the perspective of a homeowner, our 2016 codes will make any new home buyer cash positive on month one to the tune of about $31. So in other words, if it costs 20 or 30, let's say $30 more for your mortgage per month over 30 years, you're gonna save on average $61 in your electricity bill over that and natural gas bill over that month. So again, month one, you're $30 to the good. So these just seem like very, very sensible approaches to to the sort of market imperfections where there's not as much of an incentive for the market to do these sorts of things, but that's where government steps in. China has had building codes since 1985. I think this is one of the main areas for us to focus on because we've got a lot to share, I think, from California. I know we're going to talk a bit about the upcoming trip that my boss, Chair Robert Weizenmiller, will be going on to China in June, and this is one of the areas we're going to focus on. Last thing I would point to, appliances. Same thing, we periodically adopt regulations for appliances, and in December we adopted the first in the nation standards for computers. So in a year or so, once there's turnover, when you go to buy your next computer, it will have to meet the standards that we've established. And the numbers are really, really compelling. We estimate that the cost for the upgrades to the computer are on average $10 per computer. And they will return a savings over what we estimate to be an average 3-year life of a computer of $40. So you pay a little bit more for your computer on the front end, and in less than a year, you've paid back that investment, and you are making money virtually thereafter. And our estimates are conservative. They're subject to public scrutiny. Industry sometimes challenges us on what our numbers are, but these numbers, I think, are pretty solid. And indeed, as we've looked in the past, when we set a number like $10 as an estimate, industry tends to be very clever and figures out ways to beat those numbers and produce the products for even less than what we expect the cost will be. The cost on this one was a simple change to the sleep mode. Sleep mode uses a lot of electricity and doesn't need to because it's not doing anything. I stayed at a hotel last night and got up this morning. I have an old shaver, and we worked on and passed rules on chargers a couple years ago in 2012. And as I pulled the charger out of the wall, it was hot. Not burn your hand hot, but it was hot. They're not hot anymore. We adopted rules about the heat associated with the chargers so that they don't produce heat. And they were, in many cases, I remember a toothbrush, an electric toothbrush was something like, 50 cents investment that paid back, $7 or $8 over time in the electricity that it consumed. So these are things that we're very proud of and hope to share in June when we visit China again. So I thank you very much, Bruce.
And finally, this is an inside job, but Orville Schell is the Arthur Ross Director of the Asia Society Center on U.S.-China Relations, and obviously, as Drew noted, is an author of many books. And Orville, if you would, off the top, make some interesting comments, or your comments will be interesting, but make some comments about China and its relationship with California and the United States. That would be great.
Well, if you... believe, as I do, that the issue of all issues in this generation is climate change. And in the context of the wreckage of our recent presidential election, one searches for signs of hope. And so it's very gratifying to be sitting here with Matt and Drew, because actually I think they sort of embody those places where we must turn if we have any chance at all of remedying the climate change challenge. And that, of course, is to now increasingly to the subnational level. That's to states and cities and to China. The only problem is that traditionally speaking, states and cities, they don't have state departments. They don't have foreign policy. But in California, under the rather ingenious leadership of Governor Jerry Brown, California has begun to act more and more like a nation state. And indeed, I believe it is, in at least in economic terms, the sixth largest economy of the world. So it has some standing here. Now, this is very hopeful because as things sort of fall apart in Washington, they seem to be coming together out on the peripheries. We have a kind of a very hopeful form of American feudalism developing, which in my view is very healthy because it is the only alternative. Now, if you look back 10 years ago, we did a report that Steve Chu co-chaired, which was a roadmap for U.S.-China cooperation on climate change. And I remember going to China, and people were kind of very uncertain about it. And the general notion was that the Americans, the Europeans, having belched carbon into the atmosphere historically so that the burden per capita was way above that of China, we're now coming to China as equal partners and saying you have to bear equal share in solving it, namely, you would like to slow down our development to save yourselves. And they weren't really buying into it. And the transformation that we've seen over this decade has been quite startling. Here you have Matt and Drew both sort of extolling aspects of China's policy on climate change as now being somewhat a model. And I think that is true. The real question is, how are they going to who are they going to interface with here in the great United States of America? And that's why it is so important that the state of California, which really does determine how other states work. I mean, we see this in the fuel efficiency standards, and those are in jeopardy now in the Trump administration, that if California sets standards that are high, the car companies have to come to heel. And so it isn't policy out of Washington that is determining what happens. It's policy from the state of California. And so I think in the next couple years, it's incumbent upon us all to turn our attention to those areas of American governance that are still functional, where people of intelligence who believe in science, who believe in the empirical method, who believe in information, and believe that news is actually informative, these people are absolutely critical in our challenge to sort of argue with physics, the physics of climate change. And so I think this is it's a happy place for us all to be right now if we want to actually do something, because in fact something is being done. And if you're in Washington, as I was recently, we've just put a whole report out of recommendations for the Trump administration on China policy. Strangely, you would think, oh, they wouldn't care. Strangely, what we found was quite to the contrary. Everybody in the Trump administration was so bewildered by the challenge of forming a policy because they didn't know what the throne would say. They had no direction. And they were very curious to sort of interface with anybody who did have a kind of a comprehensive view of things. So I think this is the challenge for California, not just to, I remember way back in the day, I wrote a book about Jerry Brown in the 70s, and he used to have a sticker that he put on all his officials' phones. It said, Age quad agis, which in Latin means do what you are doing. And in fact, I take great heart that California is doing what it's doing. However, I think it also needs to write itself somewhat larger, not only to do more, but to make it manifest that there is something of a model emerging here for other states and ways that under these parlous times where Washington has gone missing, they too should learn how to interact with nation states and sort of take up the slack. So those are just a few cursory thoughts about where we are, but for those of us who look at this from sort of a macro view and U.S.-China policy, there is nothing more important than climate change, because this is the area where the two countries actually have gotten along. They share a common interest, and it is now a commonly recognized interest. Alas, with Washington in its present state of affairs, it falls to us here, I think, to take up that challenge, and in no insignificant way to lead the way. By pointing out what actually can be done.
So we have a problem, which is that the planet is warming. We have some solutions that have come from the state of California, and at the very time when you would hope that there would be something of a unified approach from Washington, you have essentially what could be charitably described as a very erratic approach to climate change, and that would be charitable. So my question for Matt is, one of the issues that you confront, I think, now is that you have this overarching problem. You have a lot of moral and, I think, economic and probably some legal authority. We're going to, I think, one of the things I'm pretty sure is we're going to see the issue of states' rights move forward again. But a question I have, and it builds a little bit on a conversation you and I had before we came in here, which was that now you have legislatures and governors from Nevada to the East Coast who have a slightly different perspective, but presuming that they are not completely sort of AWOL on the intellectual side, they must realize that they have a serious issue here. They do have a voter base that maybe is a bit more skeptical about the issue of climate change. So my question for you is, you must be thinking not just by leading example by example, but there must be some positive elements you can use to bring along these legislatures and governors from states that are not focused on environmentalism, not focused on climate change, not focused on sustainability. Are there any policies you have that you can demonstrate would be in their best interest and would serve the needs of the planet at the same time, potentially without so much in the way of regulation, which they find difficult to deal with?
I'll say that, you know, there are many occasions when people talk about the leadership of California and California has to be a leader. And I do tend to respond to that by saying you can't just claim to be a leader. You actually lead best by example or by action. And then whether people follow you or others follow you, that will tell whether you're a leader or not. I think Drew did a very nice job talking about some of the policies in California that we can transport or provide a model for other states. And that's one of the things that I focused on. So when we talk about California, we talk about the fact that we've got very, very ambitious programs, environmental programs, climate programs, and we are the sixth largest economy in the world. So there's some proof there that these policies can be pursued without damaging your economy. And in fact, if you look at the amount of investment in California, the reason that we have that investment is because California is seen as a place that is open to new technologies, open to new ideas, and will implement those ideas. And so that's, I think, been very, very beneficial to our economy. We do have a core of other states that we work with. I mentioned the Under Two Coalition. There are 10 other states, I believe, in that under that also belong to that Under Two Coalition. Successful states, Washington, Oregon, some of the New England states. So we try to work with those states with whom we have similar programs, similar objectives. But things that we specifically talk about when I'm talking about talking to other states, renewable energy. We talk about renewable energy and how California has, as Drew was talking about, committed itself to renewable energy and is making that happen. Now, it was very interesting. I was at a meeting of the Environmental Council of States last year, and the CEO of Appalachian Power came in to talk to the group. And what was interesting to me was he said, traditional coal is not where I'm investing right now. Coal power is not where I'm investing right now because I'm looking at the future, and the future is wind. It is solar. I don't know about whether battery technology will change fast enough to help me, but I'm not investing in new coal plants in the foreseeable future.
Do his constituents know that he said that?
His constituents were there in the audience. He said it's a matter of markets. And so it really is just a question of getting out there and talking about, here's what we're doing in California to promote renewable energy. Here's how the market has responded. And you can see the results. And so it really is going out and talking to other states and say, look, here's what we've done in California. Here's how we've made it work. Drew was also talking about the fact that we've talked about energy efficiency. So I did have a discussion at the Environmental Council States with Texas. About the president's clean power plan. And we talked about his concern that it would increase energy costs in Texas if they really had to change their grid and make significant changes in the power sector in Texas. And he said, well, and so the unintended consequence of a clean power plan will be to raise electricity rates. And I said, well, if you see that there's an issue and then you just decide not to do anything about it, then it's no longer an unintended consequence. You just decided to let it happen. In California, the way we've dealt with that is energy costs may be a little bit higher in California, but the way you deal with that is you promote energy efficiency. And so California has higher energy costs than many parts of the country. On the other hand, consumer costs in California are much lower than almost all the rest of the country. So you can deal with these issues as they come up. And so what we try to do when we're talking to other states is say, look, here's the problem, here's how we've dealt with it, here's why we think we're successful in dealing with it. And so provide those examples. Again, working with the international community is important as well. So if you're talking to West Virginia or you're talking to Kentucky, I will be honest. I will say, look, it's easier for me to talk about weaning yourself off of coal because California was really not a coal-based energy sector to begin with. On the other hand, we have partners as we're dealing with climate change from North Rhine-Westphalia, which gets 80% of its energy from coal, and half of that is from dirty lignite. And yet they're committed to dealing with climate change. We are talking realistically with representatives from China about closing down coal plants in China and how they're looking at renewables. So if the rest of the world can do it, frankly, you need to be considering how to do it, because if we don't, we're going to fall behind, because nothing stays. We were talking about being history majors. One of the things you learn from history is nothing stays the same. It is constantly changing. You have to constantly be looking at new technologies. You need to be looking at how you're going to get ahead of the curve. The rest of the world is doing that, and we need to do that as well. And I think that's one of the things that's making California successful. And I will say that, just finish by saying that one of the things that strikes me when I talk with my peers around the country is that they may have different political philosophies sitting in their gubernatorial seats. They may have different philosophies in their legislature, but they're all dealing with the same kinds of issues. They're all looking at where do we get the cheapest energy? Where can we get the cleanest energy? Because we don't want pollution. Where is the world going in terms of providing drinking water and saving drinking water resources? Are we going to need more water if the climate heats up? So at my level, everybody's dealing with the same issues, and there is a great interest in what we're doing in California.
So, Drew, that sets the stage for a question that several questions, but one that's been on my mind is that you've all described how China has already been looking at California as a model. I'm wondering if, and you've also pointed out that the governor's getting ready for the Clean Energy Ministerial in June in Beijing. So I'm wondering, what have we learned from the Chinese? Have they been able yet to make a contribution the state sees as relevant, or has it basically been us proselytizing a bit or leading by example? But as the stage gets set, question one is, what have we learned? Question two is, where are there areas where the Chinese may well have an influence on clean energy policy and technologies in the next few years?
Just to be clear, this upcoming June visit, Chair Weisenmiller is going to be chairing this event for California, and the others may be going, but we're not sure about that just now. Well, we average about one visit per week at the California Energy Commission from delegations from around the world. And many of those are from China, and they're from different parts of China. So we are exchanging information readily. I'd say the one area where we benefit a lot from China is shared research. Unfortunately, Dr. Chu wasn't here, but he started a lot of things during his tenure in Washington, D.C., and one of the things was a Clean Energy Research Council that is a joint effort between between the United States and China, and we have been beneficiaries of that. In addition, California is investing about $150 million per year in energy research, and we at the Energy Commission manage those funds, and we are going to be working on this upcoming visit with China and making sure we're sharing efforts and we're not doing the duplicating research and those sorts of things. And we're looking at possibly funding joint efforts where storage is a big deal. If we can figure out storage, we're going to really help this intermittency and this problem of energy being produced, not necessarily at the time that it's needed. But I grew up in an era where there was a promise of energy being too cheap to meter, and I'm 53 now, and it didn't happen. But if you look at solar alone, wind has similar gee whiz statistics associated with it, but one of my bosses is fond of saying that since 1980, the price of a solar module has come down over 90%. So the notion of too cheap to meter may be a little far out, but we're really approaching that quickly. So if we can partner with China on storage, which is hardly the only solution, but it's really, really a significant one, that could help a lot. I just had one other point, which is kind of related to the question you asked, Matt, and related to the same issue. The one way we're partnering with other states is through our ISO, the California Independent System Operator. They're our balancing authority, and they wheel power around to the various parts of the state that need it. And they entered into agreements that Nevada has joined, and other states have joined, and other power entities have joined, like the Pacific entity the California border with Oregon and in Washington. Pacific Corp is their name. The name slipped my mind. But this project is called EIM, Energy Imbalance Market. And what it allows is the folks at ISO to, on a couple-minute basis, shift power back and forth. So if we have an excess on a very short time period, we can send it to Wyoming or Nevada or wherever that we're connected with, and vice versa, get cheap power when they're overproducing. So the politics of Wyoming's view on energy and in general and ours don't necessarily matter when it talks about what's the most efficient thing to do. So again, I think same thing with China, we can learn a lot.
If I can add just one thing, and one of the things that struck me in working with the Chinese is their commitment to electric vehicles. So you've asked what we can learn. Well, it's BYD, Chinese company, is making electric buses for California, in California. And I think that there's a great deal of investment in electric vehicles going on in China right now. I remember that my first trip to Shenzhen, I was asked whether I wanted to see a charging station. I'd seen charging stations before, so I said, well, sure, fine, that's fine. So, well, I was taken to a 3-megawatt facility with 30 fast chargers for buses and taxis, and there was an apology because it was one of the smaller facilities that they had in China, and I said, you know, there's this whole world out there that we're not really aware of in California, in the United States. There's a great deal of progress and innovation going on in China in zero-emission vehicles, and one of the things that is common whenever we talk to a Chinese jurisdiction is their interest in promoting zero-emission vehicles. Some interesting ideas, both from a societal standpoint, okay, we're going to provide preferential parking for zero-emission trucks, for example. That's one of the ways you encourage them. And then just the innovation and investment that they're making in zero-emission vehicles right now is quite telling, and I think we can learn from it.
Bruce, just a footnote on that front. I think if we ask, you know, is this just a one-way partnership where America's teaching the poor benighted Chinese? That's really not the right way to look at this. Actually, China provides an incomparable opportunity for testing, for scaling up. I mean, where in the world can you scale things up to 1.3 billion people? And in terms of investment in new technologies. So in a certain sense, if the U.S. is sort of a fountainhead of ideas, it seems to me often where we don't follow through or can't follow through so effectively is in, making an idea real and putting it into practice. And this is where China excels. And they have a long tradition of trying things in one province, in one county, in one place, these kinds of experiments that the government can control. This is where control really is effective. And then if it works, they elaborate it much more broadly. If not, they let it go. And we just are not as efficient in this sort of phase of bringing new ideas, gestating them into reality.
So actually, Matt Norville anticipated my question, which was where the Chinese were kind of going to go next, and where we would be able to sort of, you know, work with them. So I'm going to open the floor now to some questions. And the two, we have about maybe 15 minutes, 10 minutes or so, actually. So if you do raise your hand, please tell us who you are and where you're from. And then if you could be just brief in your questions, and we'll try and have a quick back and forth on this.
My name is Edward Liu. I can understand probably Stephen Chu, after reading his morning's New York Times, probably want to hide under his blanket after reading the New York Times. But my question specifically refers, it's going to be directed at Orville and probably to the rest of panel. And, you know, we know Xi Jinping is planning to embark to Mar-a-Lago for a meet confer with Donald Trump. And after Matt Rodriguez says that EPA is being deconstructed, and I hear the news about the State Department also being deconstructed, my question to you, Orville, is climate change a dead issue now on the agenda insofar as the federal level between Trump and Xi Jinping? Is that a subject matter that's probably off the table in the upcoming meet, greet, and photo op in Florida? And having said that, my other vignette probably has to do with whether or not the green on the other side of the ocean seems to look a lot better. And my I have certain doubts about whether or not China's green energy is really that effective. I just came back from New Zealand a month ago, and I tell you, I was totally shocked when Aucklanders, 4.5 million people, and lots of Californians are trying to go there and probably stay put because of the attraction of New Zealand compared to California. Eight times the population in California. And yet, Auckland, New Zealand is having problems of California with gridlock, traffic problems in Auckland, in New Zealand, of all places. So my question to the panel, is APEC blue really happening in China, or is this just a wink, wink, oink, oink thing that looks good, that looks attractive, but yet really nothing is really happening? Okay. I know because I live in California.
Okay, so.
And I tell you, it's a mess here in California with our city in San Francisco. Every single morning,
yep.
I worry about traffic.
So I got the question. So to Orville, Mar-a-Lago, and then the question of APEC Blue, is it real or a mirage?
Well, you know, who's to say what'll happen in Mar-a-Lago? You know, Mao Zedong used to say that a sheet of blank paper was a wonderful thing because it was waiting to be written on. And in a certain sense, the U.S.-China relationship is still reasonably blank. But after April 6th, when Xi Jinping arrives in Mar-a-Lago, it'll start to be written on. And we may only hope that it will be done in a cogent and constructive way. I do think, though, as far as Washington is concerned, you're not going to see a tremendous amount of leadership globally on climate change. They seem bent on deconstructing the EPA, and who knows what they're going to do with the agreement signed in Paris, COP21. But I do think that that's a very weak reed to lean on. I'll let the others maybe answer the second part.
I'll just say that when I was in China, and let me bring it back to one of the main points, and that is your work on air pollution. One of the things that struck me was the commitment in the government officials that I work with to dealing with air pollution. And they saw the relationship between climate change and air pollution. But China's very sincere in dealing with air pollution issues. They're very committed. You want to know the commitment. We had officials from Shenzhen who were asking about vehicle emissions issues. And they said, we're dealing with one particular issue. Can you help us out on this? We'd like to know how California dealt with it. So we said, we may not be the experts, but sure, come on by. They said, well, can we come on by now? It's 9 at night, but we really need to. We're trying to get an answer for the vice mayor, and so we need to get to him. That's not an unusual occurrence. The people that you're working with are very committed. When I was at the Beijing Environmental Protection Bureau, we had a very nice dinner. We left, and the point was made. See all the lights that are on? Those are all people who are here late at night working on some of these issues. There's a great understanding that they need to do something about their environmental issues, about the quality of the air, about preserving the water in China. There are expectations in the rising Chinese middle class as to what quality of life they should have and what sort of environment that they should be looking for. And so the government is responding to that, and you see those programs, a commitment to trying to deal with some of these issues. At least that's what I've seen in China, and I've seen a large number of very, very hardworking officials who are trying to deal with these air quality and other environmental issues.
Briefly, please, and say who you are.
Hi, Nick Sarkeesian. One policy that China has done an amazing job, which I feel is not talked about very much, is its policy on reduction of meat consumption in China by 50%. And I'm just wondering if you folks have any comment about the potential impact on that in improving China's climate, both with respect to methane and other, pollution areas. It seems like that was almost a pariah to even talk about in the U.S. compared to China's head-on, facing of that issue.
Well, of course, meat production does in many ways take a lot of energy, and of course, production of methane from bovine animals is a greenhouse gas infinitely more powerful than in terms of its heat-trapping abilities than carbon. I think, to be frankly, in China, there may have been I'm not familiar with the statistic you cite, but I am also should say that over the last 20 or 30 years, the production of meat has soared astronomically. So whatever reduction there might be, it is only a relative one. And indeed, meat production in this there following the Americans. There are many other kinds of agricultural production that are also, I think, contributing to greater use of energy and climate change. I think it would be nice if people would eat less meat. I'm not sure that's the place we're going to get the world to respond first. But I do think Matt's point about air pollution, it is the gateway to remedying climate because people can see it, breathe it, smell it, and hate it. And Xi Jinping and everybody on down the line gets it. People aren't happy. So if you're going to clean up air pollution, particulate matter and such, it's not a tremendously large step beyond to also take on carbon. And that's sort of the happy paradox of conventional forms of pollution, air pollution in China.
I am Priscilla Liu. I head up a sustainable investment for Deutsche Bank and specifically is responsible for the funds in renewable energy and environmental for China. I just want to point out that there is a stark difference in terms of the way many of the coal companies in China, not to name specific names, look at the business they're in. They look at themselves as being in the energy business, not necessarily the coal business, which makes the transition a lot easier because you see them actually investing in solar farms. And so that helps them transition out of coal and then being into another business, if you will. The other point I want to point out is that many of the industries, in fact, the green industry, which I'm very, specifically working with, I sit on the Green Finance Committee for the PBOC as well. But for the green industries, it's growing at double digit versus 6.5% GDP. is growing at almost like 12%. And so if we can somehow get Washington to understand that the green industry is an opportunity, because I think a lot of the Americans, and I commute between here and China, a lot of the government thinks of today, the government is, U.S. government is very focused on capitalism and also industries making money, and they look at climate change as really kind of a feel good, do good, not really making money, if you will. But if there's a way to kind of articulate and provide quantitative information about how the green industry is actually a growing industry, just like China, which is growing at double digit, and in fact is contributing to the society's jobs and also, you know, well-being, I think it might make a difference in the way that's being viewed. And I think that that needs to be advocated. I really think that the way that climate change is being sold in the U.S. is very different than China. Because in China, the stock market, the main stock market, I think some of you may know who go to China a lot. I commute between here and China. Every 2 weeks I'm there, I'm back a week, and I'm back there 2 weeks. The stock market, the main board listing that have the traditional industries, what they do is they aim to acquire a green industry, whether it's electric car, batteries, enabling technology, just to put it into their company as a subsidiary, as being an owner, just so their stock could go up.
Okay, so that
makes a difference, and it's a mindset in terms of how the government is viewing it.
Got it. Thank you. That's a good set of questions. So, Drew or Matt, do you have a comment on that?
I just jump in and say I think your comment is very well taken. I tried to consult my notes and couldn't find it, but I believe the China 13th Five-Year Plan contemplates 13 million new clean tech jobs by 2020. This is even in a country as large as China, this is a pretty staggering number. So I'm hopeful that the situation in Washington, D.C. is fluid and there's concern about jobs. It's tragic to think that coal miners and their families are struggling. And I think that that's real. I don't think that they're being displaced by clean energy. I think they're being displaced largely by natural gas. But I think it's a fluid conversation. I think we can look to China. Back to your, what can we learn from China? They're seeing this. This is where the world is going, and I fear we're going to be left behind if we don't take this opportunity. But I think we're pretty well positioned in California.
We have time for one last question. There.
I was just wondering about.
Can you tell us who you are?
My name's Jan Thorne. I'm with Nano Architect. We're trying to bring out building materials that actually absorb CO2, that provide a thermal layer of heat, water, and toxin resistance.
Right.
And I'm just wondering how these advanced materials are being used in China, whether they're adapting that into their construction industry, also, of course, you can use BIPV.
I would suggest, honestly, the second panel is going to deal with some of these questions. And rather than this panel is more focused on the kind of government big picture, I would suggest we'll hold that question for the second panel, because it's a very good question. And I bet each one of these gentlemen can answer it, but the right panel for that conversation is the next one. So one more? Okay, here.
Which one? I have to go for it, right? Thank you, gentlemen, for sharing. And my name is Rebecca Leanne Branham. I'm from China, based in Shanghai. For 11 years ago, I started my company with my husband, and then we helped the company to do factories, you know, R&D center, everything. And then we did also U.S. Pavilion for World Expo. So during all these years, I find that it's really hard to persuade our client to use the saving energy kind of thing, the materials even, to put in the factory, because they have a different team to do different things, and then so the construction team don't care about how much they spend on the others. And then so the operation guys come on the board after we finished, and then they spend even more money. But the thing is that I was born in northern China, and it was really polluted when I was a kid. You know, I can see the dark, whatever. But it's still even worse today, I think, is because so many things in the air, the chemicals.
So what's the question?
My question is, not long ago, one of the vice mayor from my city told me, Rebecca, you know what, if you have a chance, bring the technology to the city, and then we can work on that. But, you know, for now, today we talk about strengthening the charge, leading the charge, right? For this collaboration between California and China, because China, they are focusing on the fast turnout, and then a faster track, and they want to see the result. But for this clean air and then any energy saving project, take a long time. So I'd like to ask the gentleman, talking about these issues, what's your advice for Chinese government when you work with them to persuade them or to make them to believe this will come but will take a time because they really, really try hard to push it, but they want the fast track?
Well, thank you. It's interesting to talk to the Chinese officials about how do you make decisions and how do you get everybody to work together. And all I can say is that we've had that sort of discussion with Chinese government officials, and we've talked about, okay, so is this an issue that we should be discussing with the NDRC or with the Ministry for Environmental Protection? But hold it, shouldn't we all be together? I can't tell you that California is the model on this, but I will tell you that when we talk to China, what I emphasize is that it's important for me to work with Chair Weizenmoer and with the Energy Commission, and I try to make sure that I'm also working with the Natural Resources Agency, or if we're dealing with an agricultural issue and methane, that I also reach out to the Secretary for Food and Agriculture. And one of the things we've talked about is that you need to get everybody together in the room at the same time when you're designing your programs to make sure that you're considering all perspectives. So you're not just considering how quickly you can do the building, but have you really designed the building so it can be operated and maintained efficiently? Are you going to be able to continue to have the energy efficiency, or are you going to be able to maintain that building? And so that's one of the things we've been working in and on in California, and we try to have a discussion on that point when we're talking to the Chinese officials, because it doesn't just end with the construction of a lead gold building or platinum building. You need to be able to maintain it. You need to see where it fits into the fabric of the community. You need to look at all those angles. And so that's one of the things that we've been emphasizing when we are in China and we're talking to the Chinese. You want to look at as many perspectives as you can. So, and also, it's important for us to work with the local governments as well. And that's one of the things that struck me. It really is important to understand what's actually being done at the local level. You know, it's been interesting to me to talk to representatives from the NDRC, and they have the same issues that I do. We can do whatever policies we want from Sacramento, but we need to reach down and see how they're actually being followed and implemented in the cities in order to know if we're making an impact or not. And they have the same issues. They've recognized they have the same issues in China. You can't just make it a policy in Beijing and hope that it's being implemented in Jiangsu province. They need to get out and figure out how are they going to, they need to get out there and see what's being done on the ground. So we have those discussions and we share experiences, and that's, it's not just sharing technologies, it's what works for you. How do you make sure a policy really gets implemented effectively? And so we have that kind of dialogue as well.
Rooster, I had one sentence.
I was going to ask everybody for one last 15-second bullet. So Orville, this is yours.
Let's see, I'll need a microphone. Mm-hmm. Okay. As to your question, Rebecca, I think this is both the expresses the virtues and the vices of kind of big leader culture, that when the big leader speaks and gets on board a policy, it's very effective and everybody hops too. But very often people tend to want to deliver very quick results rather than look at it over the long term, so they get the benefits in the next quarter, the next year report, or their next review, whatever. So there is a problem here of doing things in a way which isn't long term.
Drew?
I'll let Matt finish. And I just would note, in response to the question you raised, I think this is a time for incredible optimism. I think if I've been studying some of the numbers in preparation for this morning in China, and I think if this were window dressing and an attempt to show that we're doing this when we're really not, they wouldn't be putting in the enormous amount of time and energy and effort and financial investment. So I think it's really unlikely. And I also think it's just the rest of the world is going this way. So what we do for a brief period of time in this country, if you look at the long poll, some years ago there was some, we had some fits and starts with electric vehicles. I think we're there now, and I don't see the companies are climbing over one another to compete for the best electric car, and that just wasn't the way it was. So I would end with some optimism.
I'll just say it's been a pleasure being here today, and you know, I've been very fortunate to be in the position that I've been in for the last 7 years, because I've seen the world coming together to deal with the issue of climate change. I've realized that it's not just California going on its own. We have many partners around the world, in Europe, in South America, in Canada, and in particular in China. And so we've got a very, very good model of collaboration, and we're looking forward to continuing that work. There's an awful lot of work that needs to be done. We can't underestimate how significant climate change is as a problem. But I'm gratified that we've got partners to work with, and we look forward to continuing to work with them, and expect all of you in this room to step up and help us out too. So
on behalf of the Asia Society and our partners, I'd like to thank Secretary Matt Rodriguez, Drew from California Energy Commission, and Orville from the Asia Society, and thank all of you for participating. And we're going to go straight into a panel two. And I'm